Okay, well, let's think about it. Let's think about it. Drop out of here. Whoops. Suppose you have a wave. Now we can, Suppose we do it like this. And we're going to do this as a function of x, right? That's, go away. Supposed to be able to erase, there we go. X. And so we would write this wave as a times cosine 2 pi t over the period minus 2 pi x over lambda plus what phase would we need, you know, to have it be a at x equals 0? What's the phase? You've been dealing with sine waves, but let's throw a cosine wave at you. Yeah, 0. We don't need any phase at all. So to do this one, where it's exactly opposite, what would we need to do to make this cosine? What do we have to put inside here to make cosine minus 1? Add. So think, at x equals 0 and t equals 0, how do you get a minus 1? The phi, so we're going to add a term phi in there. No one's shouting out the correct answer.
Add pi.
Add pi. The phase pi will invert the wave. So that is the correct answer, is E. Let's see what people did. Most of you got it. You're smarter than the 7:30 lecture, as it turns out. They had sort of the opposite sense for D and E. Very good. Okay. So why would we want to invert a wave at all? What happens when we add two waves? You can have two sources, and putting out waves of the same wavelength, the same frequency, but if they're out of phase, they will add either constructively or destructively. We could rewrite the total y total of x and t as y1 plus y2 of x and t. And all sorts of interesting effects can occur, and we'll see a few of them today. In general, the phenomenon of interference, wave interference, arises when you have superposition of waves. Superposition itself is a very powerful principle in physics, as you've encountered already. For example, when you have gravity, right? If you have two different stars, suppose you're in a weird solar system where there are two stars, but you're a planet, you're going to feel the gravity from both of those. And it's just the sum of the two gravities that adds vectorially on you. Or if you have electromagnetic waves or something like that, they just add together. So that's how interference occurs. Constructive interference means the overall wave height will increase. Destructive means that the second wave can cancel the first one. Now, if you look at the red wave here, it's just beads on these slidey things that can go up and down. If we push up the lower one, it pushes up the red one. So all we're going to do is add this wave, which has exactly the same amplitude and wavelength as the other one, to the first one. And watch what happens. As I slide this in, if I arrange it just right there, so that the troughs of the black or the orange wave line up with the peaks of what was the red wave, it flattens it, cancels it out completely. That would correspond to our phase shift of pi. Now if I line them up, you get a bigger wave. The red one gets bigger. So it's just the sum of the two. So that's the difference between destructive and constructive interference. And of course you can have anything in between as well. So there's our two waves, y1 of x and t and y2 of x and t. And if they line up so that the peaks are on top of, occurring at the same place in the same time, you get constructive interference. You get a wave which is twice as big as the original one, if these two have the same amplitude. Whereas if they're opposite, if the peaks of one line up with the valleys of the other one, then it adds to identically zero. That's total constructive interference and total destructive interference. So now, of course, you don't, as we saw with moving this wave left and right, you don't necessarily have total destructive or total constructive interference. You can have anything in between. So what wave results when you have different phase shifts? So we're adding two waves that have the same amplitude, same frequency, and same wavelength, but just changing their phase. Now, in the case that we've drawn here, the phase difference is pi over 2. You can see that because if this is the peak of this one, the peak of this one is lining up with the place where this crosses 0. That's a 90 degree phase shift, or a phase shift of pi over 2. When they add together, you get this wave here. Okay, graphically that kind of makes sense. The peaks of this one are bigger than either of these two, but not quite twice as big as these two, since they're not completely in phase with each other. And if you look at where the maxima are occurring, it's sort of in between the two maxima of the two waves that add. That kind of makes sense intuitively too. Now, we could write down mathematically what happens as follows. We'll just go to time t equals 0. This is what we've done here, is take a snapshot. We can write that the total wave function x and time t is 0 is y1 plus y2. Now, we'll just call this, the first one we'll say just has 0 phase, and the second one has some phase phi. So we can just write them as a times sine 2 pi x over lambda, plus a sine 2 pi x over lambda plus phi. We've just eliminated the time terms, because we set t equals 0. Now when you add sine of something plus sine of something else, there's a trigonometric identity that allows you to write this as 2a cosine the difference over 2, phi over 2, and then the sum over 2, 2 pi x over lambda plus phi over 2. And what we get is square root of 2a times sine 2 pi x over lambda plus pi over 4 when we substitute in pi over 2 for the value of phi. Well, this makes a lot of sense, right? Because we see that the phase shift of this wave, the total relative to the first one, corresponds to not quite pi over 2, and it's not 0, it's pi over 4, about 45 degrees. More importantly, the amplitude here goes to the square root of 2 times a, because we had 2 times a times this cosine of the phase divided by 2. The phase, pi over 2, cosine of pi over 4 is just square root of 2 over 2. And so you get an overall factor of square root of 2. Square root of 2 is around 1.4. That means the amplitude of this total wave is 40% greater than the amplitude of the two waves that added. And of course, you could get other values. We just chose this particular phase shift, but that a phase shift of 45 degrees corresponds to an increase in the amplitude by a factor of square root of 2, or 41%. So, another clicker question. Let's see if we kind of have good intuition about how to add two waves. If we add two waves having the same frequency and wavelength, but one has amplitude 2a and the other has 3a, but some arbitrary phase, we can do whatever phase shift we want, the resulting wave, when you add the two, can have what? A, amplitude 6a, B, amplitude 4a, C, it has to have amplitude 5a, D, it can have 0 amplitude, or E, it can have any amplitude. So please talk to each other about this.